grasp onto almost anything that promises to take you to what everyone agrees is a wonderful place. But there is one catch. The only way to get there is to leave self one. So as long as you let self one be the one that takes you there, it will be there too, and you will not be able to go into the zone. If you do, even for a moment, self one will say, another way to look at the zone is that it comes as a gift. It is not a gift you can demand of yourself, but one you can ask for. How do you ask? By making your effort. What is your effort? Your effort depends on your understanding. But I would say it always involves an effort to focus and an effort to let go of self-one control. As trust increases, self-one quiets. Self-two becomes more conscious and more present. Self-one increases and the gifts are being given. If you are willing to give credit where credit is due and not think you know how to do it, the gifts are apt to be more frequent and sustainable. This may not sound scientific or may not sound as in control as you might like, but I can say that I've recorded self-two for a long time now, over 25 years consciously, and it comes at its own timing when I am ready for it. Not expecting it, somehow placing myself lower than then, when the moment is right, it comes, and I can enjoy the absence of sorrow and the presence of joy. I like it a lot. Grab for it, and it will squirt away like a slippery bar of soap. Take it for granted, and you will be present. I used to think that whatever was present in that state for me was ephemeral. Now I know that it is always there, and it is only I who leave. When I look at a young child, it is there all the time. As the child grows, it is more to distract the mind, and it is harder to recognize. But it, self too, may be the only thing which has been there and will be there your entire life. Thoughts and thinking come, but the child self, the true self, is there and will be there as long as our breath is. To enjoy it, to appreciate it, is the gift of focus. Lapses in focus. It is perplexing to wonder why we ever leave right here and now. Here and now are the only place in time when we can enjoy self or comprehension. Most of our suffering is present when we allow our minds to imagine the future or all of the past. Nonetheless, few people are ever satisfied with what they enjoy in the moment. Our desire that things be different from what they are pulls our minds into an unreal world. In consequence, we are less able to appreciate what the present has to offer. Our minds need the reality of the present only when we prefer the unreality of the past or future. To begin to understand my own mind and concentration, I had to know what I was really desiring, and it soon became clear to me that there were more desires operating in me on the court than simply to play tennis. In other words, tennis was not the only game I was playing on the court. Part of the process of attaining a concentrated state of mind is to know and resolve these conflicting desires. The following chapter attempts to shed light on this process. Chapter 8, Games People Play on the Court. That something else besides tennis is being played on the court is obvious to the most casual observer. Regardless of whether he is watching a game in a country club, a public park, or a private court, we can see players suffering everything from minor frustration to major exasperation. You will see the stomping of feet, shaking of fists, war dances, rituals, pleas, oaths, and prayers. Rackets are thrown against fences in anger, into the air for joy, or pounded against the concrete in disgust. Balls that are hit will be called out, and vice versa. Linesmen are threatened, ball boys scolded, and the integrity of the man's question. On the faces of players, we may observe in quick succession shame, pride, ecstasy, and despair. Smug complacency gives way to high anxiety, cockiness, hanging on disappointment. Anger and aggression of varying intensity are expressed both openly and in disguised forms. If the observer was watching the game for the first time, it would be hard for him to believe that all this drama could be contained on a mere tennis court between love all and game, set, and match. There is no end to the variety of attitudes.